song.
Hi, James. I just wanted to say my brushes are ready to be picked up as soon as the art shows are done. There you go. Thanks for the call out. Bye-bye.
Okay, so here I am, Carol Jers, and I was a junior at MA. I went to Switzerland for my senior year of high school, so I was only there for a year. I have very poor recollection of MA. However, I do remember some of my friends, and Beth Griswold is here with me now. Sue Moore was a friend, Jeannie McIntyre. I remember Marsha Muncy. She had a round bed that we used to jump up and down on like a trampoline. So I left MA and went to Switzerland and was in high school in Switzerland for a year and came back and went to junior college in Marin County because the family moved to Belvedere. And I worked in San Francisco for a while, and I lived in the Hague during the summer of 67, so I'm a genuine glow-in-the-dark hippie.
Okay.
And proud of it. Still have some brain cells.
Haight-Ashbury.
Yeah, that's the Haight-Ashbury. I lived on Corbett, which was down.
Okay.
Are you stopping it? I moved to Sonoma County in January of 68.
Whereabouts?
To Santa Rosa. Where did I live?
Sonoma? Santa Rosa?
No, Santa Rosa. Yeah.
Okay.
I moved to Santa Rosa.
Mm-hmm.
No, I moved to Sebastopol. That's
okay.
And what was that? 68, did I say? Yeah. And lived in Sonoma County for 25 years. Did all my schooling there at Sonoma State University.
Okay.
Came out with a master's in counseling. And then I moved up to Lake Elmore, up to near Susanville, to Chester.
Close to Pat Arnold,
yes,
Costa.
Right. And so I spent a year there, and then I got married sometime in there too.
How long were you married?
I was married for almost 10 years.
Okay.
So that was an unhappy ending. But anyway, so I lived there for about 25 years, and then moved up to Oregon. Oh, the year in between, I moved from Sonoma County to up to Chester, up to Lake Elmore area, and I was there for a year where I started.
What made you decide to move away from Chester?
Oh, I wanted to come to Oregon, yeah. But what made me move up there from Sonoma County was a friend of mine that I had met in AA, and she had moved up there with her husband, and she was also a therapist, and that's what I was working at, getting my license. And so I practiced there for a year. And then my husband lost his job, and we'd liked Oregon and had taken a trip up the Columbia River at one time.
Beautiful.
We went in 1990, we went to the International Convention for AA in Seattle, and a friend of mine had sailed up the Columbia River, so that's how I got to know
the river.
And so in 91 or 92, I think 92 is when I moved up the Hood River. And, you know, having spent that year at Lake Elmore. So I've been in Hood River ever since. I've been a practicing psychotherapist, you know.
Okay.
And worked with children and you know, the rest of the population and community mental health.
Great.
And I retired last year. And I'm just getting my feet back on the ground now. You know, retirement is a...
You hope to find a bunch of people now, too, right? Classmates you'd like to maybe see again.
Yeah. Like, I found out that Beth lived in Portland, so she and I have connected since you told me that and saw each other for the first time in 50 years, and that was totally awesome.
Good.
Yeah. So I've been looking for Sue and for Jeannie and for...
Sue Moore. Okay.
And just got your address.
Jeannie McIntyre. You have a...
lived with after I came back from Europe. And that was a disaster.
Okay. That's another
your
story.
Your dog, Jeannie. Remember your dog? Couldn't let him out. If he got out, it was all hell broke loose.
Did you ever get him back?
We did, unfortunately.
Okay.
But anyway, so yeah, I live here and I'm retired and I'm doing a lot of volunteering and life now.
And I heard that you, because of the long drive, you stayed overnight with a classmate in order to come to this gathering here at Marco's today.
Right. I came and stayed with Beth overnight.
And nice.
So working in a group home towards my teaching credential at one point. And somebody, a friend of mine, was going to South America and invited me to go. And I said, oh, okay. So I got to leave from school to do that. And I traveled around South America, to Colombia, to Ecuador, Bolivia, and down to Argentina, and all around, hitchhiking most of the time. But when I was in Peru, I did the trail to Machu Picchu. So I did the Inca Trail. We hiked it. And I was ready to quit after the first half day. I accidentally took my shoes off and put my feet in the water and didn't want to get back into my shoes because it was uphill the whole first day. But I said, if she can do it, I can do it.
And how what was the elevation you finally climbed to?
Oh, it was over 11,000 feet. Mount Hood is 11,000 feet. I think we started about 7,000. So
wow.
I don't know what the elevation was, but it was at the top. And it was, we got there after it closed, so we had to climb a fence to get.
You illegally climbed the fence.
Out.
Oh, to get out.
We got in easily, and it was under a full moon, and it just opened up for us when we got to the,
beautiful
the
memory.
Top of the stairs. Yeah, oh, it was so cool. But to get out, we'd either have to do the trail or climb a fence. And we climbed the fence and rolled down and ended up with some people's feet eating at a restaurant. And
wow.
Then we went to the hot tubs, but, you know, the agua caliente.
Okay.
In the river.
Okay, like the springs, hot springs?
Yeah, kind of like the hot springs,
mm-hmm.
But it was undeveloped, so it was really nice. So I did that, too. And that was
That's quite an achievement in your life.
It was.
How old were you when you did it?
It was the late 70s, so okay. I don't, you figure it out.
Okay, that's our assignment for tonight. Okay, all set. Addendum 3.
Addendum 2.
Okay.
So anyway, I remember that after I graduated and got my BA in sociology at Sonoma State University, I ended up going to Europe for a year. I had a friend who had been in the Peace, who was in the Peace Corps, and was trying to get down to West Africa to visit them. And so I ended up spending a year in Europe, and part of that time, Europe and North Africa. So I met somebody, I went to England and then worked my way down to Spain and then across into North Africa.
Okay.
And I was traveling alone, which ended up to be wonderful. I mean, it's hard to travel alone because you always end up with groups of people. But in North Africa, I met these guys that had a travel trailer and ended up going across North Africa with them. And crossed over to Italy, and then in Italy we got the boat to Greece, and we spent a month out on the islands of Greece.
Beautiful.
Yeah, this is like another lifetime ago. So that was part of my history too.
Magical.
And then I worked in Florence for about, for about 5 months, because my boyfriend from California was coming to meet me, and I didn't want to spend money, I wanted to save it. And that was an experience. So I'm working in a sales shop, a leather shop in Florence.
Mm.
And lived right by the Piazza Santa Croce, if anybody knows that, and the church where Michelangelo was laid down. So it was fantastic.
You've had some amazing adventures.
Yeah, I have. I love to travel. And
now you do more of it.
Reincarnated my hippie.
Okay.
Never lost the attitude, but reincarnated the hippie lifestyle. So I have a Westfalia, and I bought a kayak so I could take my dog out on the water.
Nice. What kind of dog?
I have two dogs. I have a lab and a three-legged border collie.
Okay.
And the border collie can't even get in the car, but the lab loves the water. And,
nice.
And, yeah.
Great, Carol. Thank you. Go ahead. Who are you?
Oh, my name's Mary Frisick, and I've been married up here in Portland for 26 years now. Before that, right after high school, I went to Italy with Maria Armenino. Stayed there for 3 weeks. I paid for it with my babysitting money. Mom didn't have to do anything. I just said, Mom, I'm going. And we did.
Nice.
And we took the train and we stayed with her relatives. So that was fun. I'd love to say hello to Maria. I haven't seen her in a few years, but we talked. And then from there, I went to junior college. All of them, just about, took 2 years of art, 2 years as secretary, and I didn't like that. So then I went into nursing. So 2 years of nursing, and moved to New Mexico. I lived in Wyoming, and back to California, Northern California. And now I've been 26 years.
When did you get married in this long odyssey of...
A lot. Well, when I was 29, and all my three children were born in Wyoming. So I was married 11 years to another man. And then was single for a couple of years, and my mom got babysit. My brother lives in Oroville. So he's still there. And then I met Jim through another nurse. And so nursing has been fun. You're on your feet, and you get tired, but I like to keep moving.
The excitement, do you ever work in the ER?
No, not ER, but the OR. I've seen everything, all the terrible things that can happen, and I always say I dodged that bullet. I'm so fortunate, and I've had a great time. I'm so healthy. I'm so thankful.
And you have a lot of classmates in your area.
Yeah, I do. I didn't know so many. So I got to see them next time we get together. At least once a year would be great. Right?
And you went down with a classmate down to Mazatlan, yes, where my wife Marta came from. So
yes.
Was that fun?
Just saw it, and it was really hot in May, but I loved it. And she did too. It reminded us being girls in Santa Cruz, just playing there on the beach.
You enjoyed it.
And just enjoyed it.
You got to come back like in November, December.
I think so.
The best months.
I was there once in December. They have, Mazatlan's growing, and it felt safe. I never felt scared there. Mm-hmm. And the hotels are clean. You're safe. And Joyce went with me then. That was a big surprise. We had to postpone it a year, and we finally got to go together.
I'm glad. Okay, go ahead. Addendum.
I took was my first year out of nursing. I worked a year, saved money, and I went with another nurse who drove back east for 2 months. So she was from Maine, so I got to see the Maine colors in Vermont. That was a wonderful trip. And of course, Joyce was back there then.
Hammond.
Joyce Cameron Rollick. So my future trip, so I still got to go, is Australia.
Okay.
And Alaska.
Oh, you have to take a cruise.
Yes. That's all I wanted to tell you.
Thank you.
I'm a traveling man, made a lot of stops all over the world, and in every port I own the heart of at least one lovely girl. I've a pretty señorita waiting for me down in old Mexico, and if you're ever in Alaska, stop and see my cute little Eskimo. Oh, my sweet Fraulein down in Berlin town makes my heart start to yearn, and my China doll down in old Hong Kong waits for my return. Pretty Polynesian baby over the sea, I remember the night when we walked in the sands of Waikiki and I held you oh so tight. Sweet Fraulein down in Berlin town makes my heart start to yearn, and my China doll down in old Hong Kong waits for my return. Pretty Polynesian baby over the sea, I remember the night when we walked in the sand of Waikiki and I held you oh so tight.
Okay, well, right. Well, I'm Craig Thompson. Okay. I attended Garfield Grade School, Hoover Junior High, and menlo-atherton High School for our freshman year and our junior year. I graduated from a school in Northern Idaho in 1965, so I know some of the people here. And
you were a football player too, weren't you?
Oh, yeah. As a matter of fact, that's one of the things I'm really proud of, because when I was in freshman year, I got to go. I got a varsity letter in my freshman year. I was not a starter, but there was a guy named Bruno Panducci, if you remember him. His dad was ex-49er, okay?
Yeah.
And I think the coach's name was Whitaker. I can't really remember.
Yeah, Bill Whitaker.
Yeah. And I did well enough scrimmage against Panducci that I thought that I ended up getting enough hours in varsity games to leather. And I wasn't the only freshman that did it.
Bruno was the father.
Well,
Russ and Doug.
Doug, okay. Well, that shows you the fix of 50 years of memory.
Good memory, though.
Yeah, so. But anyway, so when I got up to Idaho, you know, that little tiny school, we only had 54 people in our graduating class. I just rocked, okay, from the train. I had an MA. Then down in my junior year, I got to play football again for MA Bears. And I really enjoyed it. I was not a starter in my junior year. I somehow believed I would have been a starter in my senior, but I
You were
didn't.
A big guy.
You're, I was, yeah.
You were 6'4"?
Aggressive and assertive. And, mm-hmm. Yeah, I was gaining weight. I was young in my junior year. I started the year out as 15 and ended up 16. So I probably weighed 185 pounds during football season.
Big frame.
Right. But the next year I weighed 235 pounds. So I
bulked up
quite a bit. And then I made Panhandle All-Stars up in Northern Idaho, and which is not a big thing to anybody in the Southern Peninsula Athletic League, you know, but for a small town, Idaho, we did very well. We were undefeated season every year we played there. And I got a football scholarship at Washington State University.
Wow.
Never went there, though. My dad died that summer. That was in July 28th, 1965, and I elected to stay on the ranch and help out my mom. You want me to just go through my whole history?
Anything you like.
Well, anyway, it just, you know, without getting too
deep in the weeds.
Too crazy. I ended up getting married at 19, listed in the United States Army, not drafted, in 1967, for airborne infantry, because I was really smart, huh? Right? Yeah. What had happened is, on April 14th, I was at a place called Elkhorn Tavern in Coeur d'Alene, Idaho. They let minors sneak in there and drink, okay? And it's a great place. It's still there. It's a wonderful bar. Okay, Elkhorn Tavern. But you better know how to handle yourself around rednecks and lumberjacks and miners and stuff. But I had this guy who had been in Korea. And he asked me, basically, why aren't you in the... You look like a strong young buck. Why aren't you in the Army? I said, well, I don't believe we should be in Vietnam. He says, yeah, you weren't there. You shouldn't even talk about it. So I enlisted the next morning. Believe it or not. Showed him how wise I am and possibility of not having rash decisions. So anyway, I joined the Army, spent 3 years in the Army. First year was mostly training. I was in the paratroops. I was an infantry guy. Spent a year in Vietnam, 173rd Airborne. Made the rank of sergeant. Actually, eventually made the rank of staff sergeant.
Very good.
It was. Of course, there were a lot of job openings back then.
Yeah. I'm not going to say any more about that.
So, yeah. But my last year I spent at Fort Benning, Georgia. I taught parachuting at Ground Week at the Jump School, United States Army Airborne School. And it was good. I was a black hat, and it was a pretty good duty. And I thought about making the Army a career up until Kent State. That's May 4th, 1970. And I discovered that I wasn't really Army material. Those kids got killed, and it's a lot of people like our children's age and grandchildren's age will never know what it was like.
Tragedy.
Tragedy. And some of my coworkers, most of my coworkers, everyone but me, didn't think it was a, thought it was a great idea. They thought, you know, almost applauded, you know. And I said, yeah, I don't, this is not where I want to be. So I got out, went to school on the GI Bill, went to the University of Idaho, got a degree in chemistry, worked as a chemist, environmental chemist, various places around the world, California, Antioch, California, Michigan, just south of Detroit, Henderson, Nevada, which is right outside LA, mm-hmm. up in Tacoma. Went to work for the state of Washington, cleaned up Superfund sites. I was a project manager for cleaning up Superfund sites, a lot of military sites on Puget Sound. And then I did last 12 years of my working career, I did salmon recovery, building habitat for salmon, which was very rewarding, let me tell you.
And did you get free salmon?
Huh?
Did you get free salmon?
No, you got to pay a license to catch it like anybody else. Okay. But we did a lot of working with the various tribes around as far as rebuilding habitat that had been despoiled by chemical spills and industry in general. And it was a rewarding kind of thing. Retired at 63, my wife and I decided that we'd be snowbirds. We originally thought about just moving to Latin America. And I'd like to do that too. I really like to do it. But we have family, and Sherry is very close to her daughter. Sherry is my wife, and doesn't want to be around that long. We're not so sure. Anyway, we spent 2 winters down in Costa Rica using it as a little base operation. Wonderful country. If you haven't been to Costa Rica, you got to go there. They're a bunch of odd little people compared to us Americans, because they actually take life easy and relax and don't get upset
and smile
and smile and like everybody and live a long time in full comfort. But the last four years, we've used Mexico as our home base. And I would not recommend living where we live, mostly because it's too crowded. I don't want any competition for the rentals, but it's near Guadalajara.
Okay.
There's plenty of expat communities in Puerto Vallarta and Mazatlan and Cancun and Mérida. So by all means, if you get to all the tourist areas, your dollar goes about 6 to 1, 4 to 1. So if you only have $1,500 a month retirement income, it's like living on anywhere from $7,000 to $5,000 a month. So for those of you who haven't been blessed as well, Sherry and I should do that. You can rent a place, a couple hundred, well, maybe $600 a month, that's including utilities, and maybe another $600 for food and $300 for tequila, I guess.
It's a good deal.
Yeah. So we have a great life, thanks the Lord, and my wife, who's not here right now, so we can't include her.
Tell us about how you almost died in 2004.
Well, this is interesting. November 17th, 2004, I was home. I was telecommuting or something and doing my laundry at the same time. And my wife had a lunch appointment with her friend. We lived like 13 miles out of town, an area called East Olympia. And so she took off, and then she showed up, came back, and she says, "Are you okay?" I said, "Yeah." And she said, "Well, I was told to come back, that you needed my help." And by told, we were talking about the Holy Spirit of God. I'm not going to preach religions to anybody, but this is my explanation of what happened. And so she looked kind of disappointed in a way that I didn't need her help. So she said, "Well, I guess I'll go join Mary Lou for lunch." And so she starts out the door, and I turn the corner into our bedroom, and I drop dead. I have sudden cardiac arrest. Heart just stops. Boop. A lot of guessing about why that was. Some people said, well, maybe a little piece of, blockage came up and hit your brain or something like that.
Mm-hmm.
Nobody really knows. And I was dead, so I can't contribute much. So my wife comes in, and first thing she did, this is her input, not me hearing it, saying, "Are you okay? Are you okay?" So she figures she should call 911 because I wasn't able to respond to her, And by the way, that's something, it's like if somebody hits you in like your knee and you fall to the ground, or your testicles and you fall to the ground, the first impulse is, "Are you okay?" "No, I'm not okay. I'm laying on the ground."
Yes.
So, anyway, she called 911. This guy actually got the Red Cross Hero of the Year for 3 counties in Western Washington for talking her through this CPR she was doing. And he's a really great guy. He was. So did a good job. So Sherry, he asked her, is he breathing? And she says, yes. So he says, "Well, put the phone down by his mouth." He puts the phone down by my mouth. And she says, or he says, that's his death rattle. Because when you die, the last air comes out. So of course, Sherry performs mouth to mouth and whatever she had to do. And he calls the East Olympia Fire Department, which is our closest fire to people. They happen to be having a seminar out there for 15 EMTs on, guess what, use of a defibrillator. So they come on out, come over, and they run Sherry out of the room, because I've never seen it, but I know they like stab your heart with needles and syringes and all that, and they hit you with the hepato, and it causes flesh to burn, all that kind of stuff. So they didn't want her to go through it. She'd already done plenty of things, okay? Plenty of things for it. But what happens, they had hit me 9 times with the paddle. And they won't admit they were doing anything but their job. And they did a great job, okay? And normally, about after the 4th time, I've always heard that your brain's kind of fried and you're not worth resuscitating. They hit me 9 times. So I kind of suspect they were like, well, it is a class, let's see what happens. But anyway, after ninth, my heart started beating again. And that's kind of what they thought, well, maybe it was like something was lodging, maybe all the jerks finally lost something up. I don't know. My body chemistry had no problem with cholesterol. Had played three games of basketball the night before. You know, I was in pretty good shape. But, I don't know, 2010, they finally said, well, it probably was due to Agent Orange exposure. You know, apparently that can cause arterial sclerosis. Don't need blocking, hardening of the arteries due for your standard cholesterol or fat diet. It does bad things to people. Anyway, so the VA had actually decided to call me disabled in part for that. Anyway, get back to the story. So after the heart beats, about an hour and a half later, I can breathe by myself. But they can't get my heart stabilized. Right now I have a little pacemaker defibrillator. Sure. I'm not going to pull Lyndon Johnson and show you my scars or anything like that. But, so they wake me up. They sedate me. Apparently, I probably would have been screaming in pain like crazy if I had been conscious. But I didn't have a directive at the time, which I suggest you all get. So they had to get permission from me to do it. Because it wasn't immediately life-threatening, but something they thought needed to do. So anyway, they wake me up, and they explain the situation. Dr. Wark, who I just saw 2 weeks ago, says, hi, you know, basically, we'd like to put a pacemaker into your chest because we can't get you stable. And I said, well, what happens if you don't? And he says, well, you kind of have a choice. You either do this now or you'll be dead sometime this week.
So a tough decision.
A pretty easy one. Mm-hmm. So he did it, put in. 7 years ago, they pulled out, put a new one, a new upgraded model. I couldn't ride a motorcycle with my old pacemaker. Now I can.
Okay, good.
So, I guess that's about it. I worked and I retired. I already mentioned my work that's
yeah.
And what I'm doing. So,
well, people, do you remember anybody from MA at all?
I remember a lot of people from MA, but you know, it's
Jim Vaughn.
Yeah, I knew Jim Vaughn and
Bob Stewart.
Bob Stewart, of course, and Jenny Bove, Sandy Vargas, Carol Borba.
Yeah.
See, I'm still in contact with Carol.
So okay.
Is he Patricia Zoller, who was older than us.
Okay.
You, Tom, of course, and yeah. Of course, Jim Weed, which you haven't found yet.
No.
And John Browning, okay. Nikki Briggs, who's passed away.
Yes.
And Maria.
Armenino.
Yeah, I was the luckiest guy in the world because I had the biggest cojones in the world. I was the guy to ask the beautiful...
And she said yes?
...to go to the junior prom, yeah. Yeah, she did. We didn't have a great time. I mean, I didn't even kiss goodnight, okay? But she's a little lady, that's fine. Uh-huh. I was the envy of half the people at MA.
Yeah. That day. She got the brass ring.
I think John was the other end. We had a lot of fun with
mm-hmm.
Bill Carberry, I remember him too. And, I mean, there was Dick Roth and a lot of people I didn't really hang with. I mean, mm-hmm. everybody knows Greg Buckingham and Lindsay. Older and younger. And
yeah. Our Greg Buckingham was not in that family.
Yeah.
He was a non-swimmer.
Oh, okay.
So the other Greg Buckingham was a year older, I think.
Oh, really? Okay.
Everybody gets confused on that
sure.
one.
Yeah. Danny White, who was a year older, and Eleanor, who was a year younger. I mean, so...
And what elementary school did you go to?
I went to Garfield. Garfield
okay.
Giant. Woohoo!
Yeah. Okay. Jeez. What a memory.
Yeah, right.
And, any pretty girls there you remember from?
Yeah, of course. Carol.
Carol?
Janet Dance, Donna Garcia. I think I told you Donna was. Actually, my girlfriend was Patsy Owens. Okay. Pat Owens, yeah.
I've been looking for her.
Well, I'd like to find her too. But
Pat Owens, last I know, down San Luis Obispo.
Really? That's a good one. And then Cindy Wilson.
I just saw her in Reno.
Okay.
Cindy Wilson,
okay.
Yes.
See, the Garfield people, they didn't all go to MA, okay? But there was Ralph Abernathy, Bobby Azevedo, Odie Hansen, me and Cindy Wilson. We're sort of like the R gang back in first grade.
Yes.
Literally, all in the same area. All one
She watches these videos. She's going to be delighted.
Yeah, well, I still love her, but like a friend.
Uh-huh. Have you talked to her at all?
No. In fact, I asked Carol Borba, who was in contact, and said she didn't want to contact
her. No, not true. She'd love to talk to you.
Well, anyway.
Well, that's great. Well,
anyway, so I remember, and Donna, I think I mentioned that Donna Garcia,
uh-huh.
You know, she was born December 2nd.
Okay.
I was born December
1st. You have great memory.
And she never acted like she liked me at all. I mean, even uh-huh. as a person. But she was just this beautiful
Sweet.
Girl that we, little girl. We lived on 8th Avenue, and I'd walk to school, and she'd be there. And yeah.
We got fond
and
memories.
I met Sandy Vargas and Danny Bowl and Maria and that.
Okay.
Yeah.
And you're living right now in this place, Lacey?
Yeah, Lacey, Washington. Wonderful, nowhere, Washington.
Okay.
Just outside Olympia, Washington.
Okay.
It's actually a really nice place in the spring and the summer.
Very nice.
And we downsized this because we're doing this foreign travel stuff.
Yeah.
So we have and also because we're older, we would need a one-story house. In
Do you drive down to Mexico?
No,
or
we
so
fly.
Okay, you fly.
We rent a car, so it's a... I'm not trying to brag. We're doing okay money-wise.
Okay.
All right, so
well, that's wonderful.
I can rent a car down there. And we like
I'm sure I'll see you at some point down in Mexico.
It'd be nice. I wanted to. I'll give you a hint. You know, you can literally fly from Seattle, Washington, Guadalajara, first class for an extra $60 a ticket. Believe it or not.
I'm going to remember that.
All right. So it just
remember that, everybody.
Yeah.
Good deal.
Yeah, their deals are there if you look for them. Or if you're up in the Northwest, you go to Vancouver, you go Jetway aircraft.
JetBlue or
whatever. It has Jet in the name.
Okay.
Go direct to Puerto Vallarta. Dirt cheap.
Really?
Yeah, it doesn't help you if you're in L.A., you know. But
these are good things to know.
Yeah, it really is. So
well, thank you very much.
Yeah.
Okay, Craig, my best.
Yeah.